Ambassador Manju Puri ji, whom I am working with in various capacities in for last 5 years. First time when he was in Belgium, I had opportunity to work with him when Prime Minister Modi was to visit there. And I must tell you this because it was a very critical moment. As usual, I went there for preparations of the event. We finalized everything and I left Brussels airport, and after exactly 24 hours there was a big terrorist attack on Brussels airport. You might remember that. And in fact, some of my colleagues who have come from London had to stay back in Brussels for 3 days because all the transportation was closed from Belgium to outside world. And we were all in question mark whether, number one, if Prime Minister Modi will actually visit there, and number two, if he visits, can we have a big program like 5,000 people at audience in such an environment. But he was determined to do it, and only because of his support and very clear message to Indian government that yes, we can still go ahead with the tour. And in fact, Mr. Frank, Modi was the first foreign dignitaries who visited Belgium after that terrorist attack. So it was under his leadership that visit was exceptionally successful, and so was the program. So I know how capable he is, and therefore I am not surprised how popular he is in this country. So thank you for little overwhelming introduction of mine. I don't know how much I really deserve that. Also thank you all of you for coming here. I know many senior dignitaries are sitting here. Some of them I had a chance to meet in last 2 days. Some of them I would definitely try to meet them in my next visit. So thank you for all seniors to come here. Let me put 3 or 4 things in the proper perspective before we open this for discussion. So first thing, Ambassador Puri ji has already defined that you need to comprehend and sink in the extent of victory of Mr. Modi to understand today's India. And I am not telling you out of arrogance, but it is a fact of the matter. It is for the first time there was kind of a pro-incumbency wave where we got more vote share, more number of seats in many more states where we were not strong in past, and from all sections of society, including minorities. We have literally in close to 12 states today in India, Congress, Indian National Congress has no presence in Lok Sabha. In most of the states except Kerala and Tamil Nadu, Congress couldn't win even two digit seats, more than 10 seats. And in Tamil Nadu they have won because they had an alliance with the regional partner, otherwise their also number would have been close to zero. So this is the scale of victory, and that is possible, as I always tell you, I won't go into the details, for 3 reasons. One is obvious, second is less obvious, and third is very little visible. First is that our strong stand on national security and against terrorism. Second is the development agenda of Prime Minister Modi, which has touched the hearts of millions and changed the lives of millions of families. So all these schemes, we are not only on paper, and you can go into the towns and villages of India and actually see the pulse of people to understand that how much the lives of people have been changed by simple schemes like building a toilet or giving a cooking gas or giving a unsecured loan of 50,000 or 1 lakh rupees to the street vendor, or opening the zero balance bank account, which we opened for 30 crore people. So this has actually impacted the lives of people, millions of people, for good. And in return, they have voted for us. And third and equally important part, which is not very well documented so far, is the contribution of our party president, Shri Amit Shah, who has created a formidable party infrastructure from national level to the youth level. And when we say that we have 10 crore plus members, they are only not on paper. We were able to touch upon them, we were able to activate them, motivate them during the campaign, and the result is here. So these are the three things I would like to emphasize to understand the scale of the victory of Bharatiya Janata Party under the leadership of Mr. Modi. The second part is, India is growing at quite a fast rate. We are already thinking of being the economy of $5 trillion. If you take, now we are 6th or 7th economy in the world, but if you take in terms of pricing parity, we are already 3rd. On the global stage, India has gained its importance in last 5 years like nothing in the past. We have overcome all our previous inhibitions, barriers, defensive tactics like non-aligned movement, and we are saying that we will make alignment based on our national interest, our own security interests. And to tell you one instance of how important India is today, is you need to observe what has happened in last year's G20 summit in Buenos Aires. In Buenos Aires, you know that when there are multilateral summits, there are always on sidelines, there are bilateral talks between the leaders of the government. There were two trilateral talks. And interesting part is, India was the only common country between two trilateral talks. One was between US, Japan and India, and second was between Russia, China and again India, represented by Prime Minister Modi. Essentially what it depicts, that both these emerging blocs would like to have India as a part of their larger game plan. And therefore, the kind of importance India is gaining on multilateral forum is unprecedented. It doesn't mean that we are ignoring our traditional partners, traditional states and neighbors. For example, the number of countries we have covered in Africa by the visit of either Prime Minister, President or Vice President is close to 50. And in last 20 years, not even 15 African countries were visited by any Indian head of state or head of government. Even in neighbor, you know that close to 15 years before Prime Minister Modi's visit to Nepal, there was no visit of Indian Prime Minister to Nepal. 17 years, yeah. So Modi ji has already visited here 3 times. He has visited Maldives, Sri Lanka, even Pakistan for that matter. So we are equally thoughtful to have very strong relations with all our neighbors, including Pakistan. But Pakistan has to do few things before we start our formal dialogue. As you all know that in the first swearing-in ceremony, he has invited all the SAARC leaders. This time he has invited all the BIMSTEC leaders, and both the time Prime Minister Kohli was a part of the dignitaries who have attended the swearing-in ceremony of Modi ji. So we are here to have all over development partnership with our neighbors. His foreign policy also has four or five salient features which I will jot down before I go to the India-Nepal relations. One is that today under his leadership, India's domestic policies and global policies are tightly integrated. We are no more working in silos as far as our these two policies are concerned. To give an example, India's big campaign like Digital India is also part of our diplomacy now. Not only such campaigns which has direct impact on investments and employment, but social endeavors like Swachh Bharat, like building a toilet, like Ganga. These projects, which are essentially domestic projects, are also now part of our global diplomacy. And a lot of international companies, lot of countries are interested through their social entrepreneurship channel to invest in it for the goodwill of India. Second is that there were issues, as I told you, it was not only an issue with Nepal that India head of the government has also visited. I can give you a list of some 7, 8, 10 countries like Nepal, Sri Lanka, Canada, even UAE, Mongolia, Israel, where Indian Prime Minister has not visited for 2 decades, 3 decades. With Israel and Mongolia, no Indian Prime Minister ever visited before Modi ji. So in last 5 years, Modi ji was able to cover all that gap. We also have overcome what we call it as our historical hesitations. Means if we used to think that if we go to Israel, our rural friends would not feel good, or our domestic food bank will go against it. But Modi ji has visited all major Gulf countries, then visited Israel. He has also de-hyphenated very successfully a traditional hyphenation. For example, if you visit Israel, you are bound to visit Palestine. But he has visited Israel separately, he has visited Palestine separately. So he has actually dismantled all the conventional assumptions in the global diplomacy. Third part, which is also equally important, is that India today has overcome what is called as a strategic restraint. Our restraints has become, instead of become our virtue, it has become our liability to an extent in the past. And we have overcome it first by surgical strikes, after Uri terrorist attack, and after Pulwama attack, the Balakot airstrike. And Mr. Modi has made it very clear that response every time will be equally reciprocal and proportionate. Fourth dimension of Mr. Modi's foreign policy is the civilizational connect. And in that respect, Nepal of course plays a very important role. Last time he came and he started his visit from Janakpur, which is not only a symbolic, but also it is a strengthening of our civilizational bonds. Everyone is telling me since yesterday that since he visited Mukteshwar, the number of Indian tourists coming there has gone up by several fold. And he has done it at every place. He has gone to Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Mauritius, even in China, Mongolia. Wherever there is Indian civilizational connect, he has tried to re-establish it, revitalize it, and make it this a part of our soft power. It includes yoga also. And last but not least, which everyone before me has mentioned, that India has a large diaspora, which was taken for granted by almost all governments in past. without doing anything substantial for them except talking some good words. So Modi ji has reconnected them, revitalized their India connect, and in a way I won't go into details except telling two things what has happened. Number one, Indian diaspora today is feeling much more empowered, much more connected with India. They would like to participate in India's development story, and most importantly, their stature in that country has gone up because of Mr. Modi. In many places, they have been seen now as a political power, where they have substantial number. So this is a new Indian diaspora, which is not only emotionally connect with India, but also would like to be a part of India's development story. It is not so easy to achieve all this in 5 years' term, because you know how slow Indian any diplomacy works, and that therefore the credit goes to him. So if you put all these things in the context and then try to evaluate India-Nepal relations, and I don't have to emphasize on how civilizationally we are close, religiously we are close, people-to-people contact, how wide our boundary is. But in terms of investments, in terms of education, in terms of environment, even in terms of innovation, there are enormous things which we can do, and the sky is the limit. But at the same time, what we need to understand that this has to be a win-win situation for both the countries. It cannot be a one-sided affair, only advantage of one country, that includes India. Therefore, India cannot say that I will do something only because it helps me, but it actually damages the other country, in this case Nepal. So win-win situation can happen only when both the countries see that this partnership is working. Now in last 5 years, your country has gone up through several changes, and I really congratulate all of you for the setting of the democratic system in this country. And therefore, we can build a relationship on the pragmatism, which is based on winning both the sides, and at the same time, deepening our civilizational connect. I know there is a section of people here in Nepal who think that India has kind of a big design to overwhelm Nepal or dominate Nepal polity, Nepal civic structure, etc. On behalf of all of us in India, I would like to assure you again that there is no such sinister design. We are fully aware that you are a sovereign country. It is up to you to decide your fate. It is up to you to charter your path of development and prosperity. We are here to extend our helping hand. We are here to extend our hand of cooperation on an equal term basis. I am emphasizing it. On an equal term basis, we won't like to dominate you. So this is something which I want to reassure you emphatically. There will be an issues where we will agree. There will be an issues where we may not agree. Any two countries, it doesn't have to have 100% agreement. Even the NATO countries, which is the world's strongest and oldest alliance today, has so many differences within. But our bonds of friendship are much stronger, and we should see that they don't get weakened in spite of these differences. So this is the framework I would like to put in today. I don't want to go into the details of all the schemes and what happened, etc., because anyway, I am not directly involved in the policy formation. I am not a part of the government. And also, more than that, these issues will emerge, and these issues will come up. There is no question about it. If we resolve one issue, there will be another issue. But the basic strength of our relationship is a trust and a mutual respect on which we should go ahead. That's all I want to say. Thank you very much. Generate electricity. So in that respect, how to put Nepal's hydropower vis-a-vis the domestically generated electricity. So these are all complex questions. We don't have immediate answers. I just want to leave it for your thought. One another thing about this vehicles transfer, etc. I have heard about it. I have also discussed it with Ambassador Puriji, and we will take it at appropriate level. About this mobile rate, etc., we should not go into it. It is determined by the market. If the market grows, rates will come down. Modi ji has already brought it down by 35% after his first visit. But in India, anyway, the sale rates are not determined by the government. It is all determined by the private company. So, and India now, right now, has the cheapest data and call rates available anywhere in the world. So, if there is enough market, I am sure the rates will go down. As far as the SAR and Pakistan is concerned, because that is something has been raised, I understand that Nepal being heading the SAR this year, it has a special interest in convening the meeting. But the kind of situation we have with Pakistan, it is quite difficult for India to sit across the table and discuss anything meaningfully. And that does not only involves the multilateral forums, but also we are not engaging with Pakistan right now, even on the bilateral side. The situation most likely will remain as it is till Pakistan takes some concrete actions against the menace of terrorism emerging out of their soil. And let me make one thing very clear and categorical, and we have done it when Mr. Trump also offered to mediate, etc., that this is purely a bilateral issue. We would like to deal directly with Pakistan. And BJP as a political party, I have made this statement 2-3 times in the past also, so I would like to repeat it, that we as a party does not have any ideological compulsion to talk to Pakistan. Other parties might have it, we don't have it. So we will do it purely on a national interest basis and let the government decide it when to talk to Pakistan. So SAARC meeting might be a collateral casualty of all this. I'm sorry about it. But in the current circumstances, SAARC with Pakistan, for India, it's a difficult proposition. The last but most important thing, I would like to reassure this, that I have mentioned 2-3 things. The equitable partnership, collaborative partnership, where both the countries will have win-win situation. We have done it with other countries, including some countries in Africa and other neighbors like Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, where investments in that country is not exploitative by any chance, exploitative to environment, exploitative to local traditions and customs, exploitative to the local economy. On the other hand, Indian investments are always nurturing the local economy, local investments, etc. It is up to, I don't want to compare, therefore, our model of collaboration and cooperation with other countries with that of model of other countries. And we will do it our way. Maybe it will be a smaller scale than other countries, but that is the way we will be. The last thing is that some misconception, misperception carried out, especially in this country. And therefore, I would like to make a very categorical statement that India stands firmly for the unity and the territorial integrity of Nepal as one country and one nation, and sovereign nation. So let us not have any slightest doubt about it in anyone's mind, and I am sure Ambassador will endorse this on behalf of government also. So let us, sometimes it is important that if the things are not moving, let us hit a reboot button and start again. India-Nepal relations are definitely not such a bad situation that we need a reboot button. But wherever there are some pain points, we should specifically address it on a very pragmatic and rational basis, and that itself will be a beginning of a solution rather than getting into the every issue being a very emotional one. I have come from a science background, so I would like to think rationally and pragmatically rather than having very big daydreams. Start something small, resolve it, and that will lead to a big collaboration and big cooperation. So I request all of you to look at India, at its neighbor, at its friend, non-dominating friend, and a collaborative friend, and that itself will resolve half of the issues between India and Nepal. Thank you very much. Yes, sir.